You're listening to the KSN Podcast, and today we're revisiting condominium deconversions. Welcome to the KSN Podcast, where you'll hear from Kovitz, Shifrin, Nesbit attorneys as they share their experience and insight on legal issues surrounding community associations, collections, property tax appeals, and landlord-tenant law. I'm Bernie, and today we're joined by KSN attorney Kelly Elmore. Kelly is a principal at Kovitz, Shifrin, Nesbit, and for over 15 years, she's been representing big and small, city and suburban, condo, homeowner, and townhome associations.
That's right. It's good to be here, Bernie, and I'm ready to discuss a really hot topic today.
Here we go. We discussed this topic over a year ago. In the meantime, you've written articles addressing condo deconversions. You've spoken at several industry events, conferences, and trade shows on the topic, and it's on the forefront now more than ever. Why is that, Kelly?
Well, a few years ago when this entire process started, we knew it was a response to market conditions, low interest rates for buyers, and I think most of us in the industry expected to see it disappear after about a year or so. But here we are 3 years later, and it is continuing to boom, especially out in the suburban areas. I think still diminishing home ownership among seniors, increased single-person households, strict mortgage lending standards are just some of the factors that have created a demand for rental units. So as long as this demand for rental units continues, I think we're going to see the deconversion trend continue.
And we can just look at December 2018 as a perfect example of this continuing trend. So in a record-breaking month, Kovitz, Shifrin, Nesbit attorneys, including you, Kelly, overcame a ton of significant obstacles to close on the sale of 900 condominium units in less than 2 weeks. So this is while in December 2018, and it included the sale of Flats on LaSalle Condominium Association, Surfside Condominium Association, and 449 units in the River City Condo Association. And the sale of all 900 units for Flats on LaSalle, River City, and Surfside were approved by a vote of the unit owners in each respective association, and that's all specified in Section 15 of the Illinois Condominium Property Act. Is that right?
That is correct. Section 15 of the Act is a relatively small provision in the much larger Condominium Property Act, and Section 15 says that, with some exception, that if 75% of owners in a particular association vote to elect to sell their association, all owners in the property are required to sell. There are some different requirements for smaller associations, but generally the buildings we've been working with, the threshold is 75%.
And we're talking about incredibly complex real estate transactions. So where a potential buyer isn't interested in one condo where they could follow the traditional process, like working with a realtor, negotiating with a seller, going through an inspection or through the closing process. A deconversion is countless other steps because a buyer is interested in every unit in the building. So from half a dozen units to hundreds of condos.
That's correct.
All right, so a great place to start is the River City Condominium Association.
My favorite deal. So I think, as maybe some of our listeners might know, it was a very highly publicized deconversion deal. To date, still the largest deconversion in downtown Chicago history at 449 units. It was quite a tumultuous three-year process. When we began back in 2015, when I think very few people in the city had really heard of Section 15 or knew what a deconversion sale was, our client, River City, received an unsolicited offer, and that started a three-year journey. Really educating the ownership on what a deconversion sale was. I think a lot of owners at the time had the question, is this something that really is even legal? How can this possibly be the case where I'm an owner in a condominium association and I can be forced to sell my unit? And I would say that that sale really sparked a lot of notoriety with deconversion deals. Now, as we sit here today in 2019, so many deals have now occurred. Our firm has closed 33, getting ready to close our 34th. And I think the discussion about deconversions is much more commonplace. It doesn't seem to elicit the same sort of fear and anxiety as owners now understand. This is a relatively common practice in the Chicagoland area, especially as we're seeing it continue.
So a common practice, but a complex transaction, because you're talking administrative, regulatory complications that all pop up throughout the entire sales process, right?
That's correct. And if you think conceptually about what a deconversion or Section 15 sale is, in large buildings where we are working with all of the owners to collect their closing documents, clear the title on their units to get the owners ready for sale, there's a lot of moving pieces and parts. And that's why it's, if you haven't worked with a firm that has done these deals or a buyer that has experience doing these deals, it can be very, very difficult. In River City alone, we faced over the 3-year period owners who challenged the vote of the ownership after they had obtained the 75%. There were owners who rallied against the board, who simply didn't want to sell and didn't want to move. We faced also litigation against several owners who failed to cooperate in completing their closing documents. So, you know, as you're moving forward, trying to get all owners to complete the closing documents and get everyone ready for the sale, we were also behind the scenes facing a lot of different obstacles on the back end, just trying to resolve issues so that we would be ready for that big closing date.
And of course, all of this happening during the holiday season in December.
It certainly did. In the beginning of October, we received an emergency complaint filed by owners who, I think, based on some false information, thought that the ownership had not, in fact, voted with the 75% in favor of the sale. It was later confirmed that they had well over the 75%, but unfortunately, a 6-week litigation ensued. We were very fortunate to have a judge who was able to put us on a fast track and give us a very quick closing date, or excuse me, a very short trial date. And so that helped us move the case along and ultimately concluded in favor of the association, and we were able to close towards the end of December.
So after multiple votes, litigation, complaints, again, administrative issues that are just that are countless, in the end, the transaction finishes at a sale price of just under $92 million. And at the time of the recording that we're doing now, the sale of River City is the largest condominium deconversion in downtown Chicago. But Kelly, there are other deconversion transactions that you have been involved with, and we'll discuss them after the break.
Hi, I'm attorney Joseph Sharnak, and I'd like to ask you if you downloaded the KSN app. Here are some of the app's features. 24/7 real-time access to KSN's collection status online, the CSO. It's a portal that features updates on active collections, foreclosures, and landlord-tenant matters. Articles and booklets authored by KSN's experienced association, tax, and landlord-tenant lawyers. Access to our schedule of upcoming educational events. And you can view snapshot profiles of all of KSN's attorneys with their contact information and mobile accessibility. The KSN app is now available for free download in the iTunes App Store for your iPhone and iPad. The app is also available for download in the Google Play Store for your Android phone or Android tablet. Just search for Kovitz, Shifrin, Nesbit. We invite you to download the KSN app and learn what our law firm can do for you. We look forward to demonstrating how Kovitz, Shifrin, Nesbit has earned the trust of thousands of clients for over 30 years.
And we're back. Like I mentioned before, the sale of River City is the largest condominium deconversion in downtown Chicago, but it closed just 10 months after the second largest deconversion sale, and that was 296 units of Century Tower Private Residences Condominium Association. It's a mouthful. And that happened February 2018. And KSN advised on several legal issues. So Kelly, let's talk about that transaction and some of the others that you've been involved in.
All right. So actually going back to Century Tower, which is the second largest deconversion in downtown Chicago, that building also faced a number of hurdles as we geared up for the closing, which was originally anticipated in January and then for various issues was moved to February. In that particular building situation, we didn't necessarily have massive litigation with owners complaining about the sale, but we had some unique situations dealing with the commercial space owner, getting the documents we needed. And as many people may know, that oftentimes in these association buildings, you often have commercial space that has to be involved in the sale, whether the buyer is going to be purchasing that commercial space or whether there just needs to be a sign off by the commercial space owner. Fortunately, we were able to successfully close that one in February, and right before the closing date, got a notice from the city of Chicago as to new code violation issues. So I always say on these deals, anything can happen. And as long as you have a sophisticated deconversion department and law firm that is experienced in these deals, you can handle any of the issues that come up.
All right. And that's where I'm going to put you on the spot, Kelly. So why is KSN well-equipped to handle these transactions, these bulk condo deconversions?
I think the thing that makes KSN so unique in handling these deconversion sales is, first and foremost, unparalleled, we have the most experienced in handling these deconversions. I think most firms are lucky enough to handle one or two per year. We have been handling at least 10 a year. And as I mentioned earlier, we have already closed 33 deals just since 2016. When we originally started this process, we had a deconversion group of two individuals, myself and another attorney, and then we were utilizing a paralegal to assist us. And we have steadily grown our department to 16 individuals just dedicated to handling deconversions.
And I mean, you really need that many people to handle 900 units closing in a month. I mean, it just makes sense.
Absolutely. And you also keep in mind, you're often not just dealing with one deconversion sale at a time. We currently have about 15 in various stages that are moving towards a closing date. So you need a team of people who can not only be focused on the closing date that's coming up, but also keeping track of and staying on top of the other pending deals. But another feature I would say that KSN offers to clients who are considering going through this process is we have sophisticated litigation department, real estate groups, and other departments so that if you have, let's suppose, litigation filed at the last minute before your closing, you immediately have a department that can handle that. Or we have a unique relationship with the city of Chicago where we're able to work through code violation issues on a very efficient and fast-tracked basis. So those are the types of relationships and departments that an association needs if they're going to consider one of these sales.
And just an example, some of the sales, so as of April 2019, like you mentioned, KSN has completed 33 of them. River City obviously being the big one at 449 units. But then we can go back into January of 2017, 625 Wrightwood, and that's a Lincoln Park Condominium Association. And this is where you start getting into, it's not just clearly residential units, but you're also dealing with parking units. And in that case, the Wrightwood Condominium Association had 98 units, residential and parking.
Correct, yeah.
You have Clifton Village, a Northside Chicago Condo Association, 38 residential units. And I think it'd be dismissive to think 38 units is simple. I mean, it's still 38 different closings that you're working on at the same time with 38 plus personalities, people who have their own issues, either tenants, lease agreements, other things that are happening in their life, and you're trying to kind of put this all together.
That's right. I think as one of our board presidents who went through this deconversion said it best, when you are handling a 300 unit or 100 unit deconversion, getting everyone ready for the closing is like trying to get 100 people to look directly at the camera and smile all at the same time. And you have that perfect instance where it all comes together and you're able to do the closing.
And I'm sure it has not resulted in some long work days and sleepless nights, Kelly.
December was pretty crazy.
That's right. So we've talked about some of the deconversions that you've been involved with, how complex, but how did they start?
So a deconversion process could start in an association in a number of different ways. One of the most common is that associations might receive an unsolicited offer, meaning the board wasn't out actively looking to sell the building, owners weren't actively looking to sell the building, but possibly a buyer or a broker in the area, for whatever reason, located the property and thought they might be an ideal candidate. And so an unsolicited offer or letter of intent is sent to the building, and that can start the process. The other way is that someone in the ownership or on the board might decide that the property might be a good candidate for a deconversion and initiate the process either through directly with buyers or through a broker.
If your association is being approached by an interested buyer, what should they do, Kelly?
What we always advise board members is that if you receive an unsolicited offer or certainly a contract for sale, it truly is incumbent upon the board to ensure that that is put to a vote of the ownership. If the board has received an unsolicited offer, or if the board, for whatever reason, feels that this might be an ideal situation to consider a deconversion for their association, get the issue out in front of the owners. Let the owners know that this is something you might be considering. Just bringing up the issue at a meeting doesn't mean that the building's going to be sold overnight. I always say the beauty of a Section 15 sale is that the owners make the decision, not the board members. So eventually, whether the property is sold will be a unit owner decision, but the board is really in charge with facilitating the information, educating the owners, and that's something that we're happy to help boards do.
That was attorney Kelly Elmore, a principal at Kovitz, Shifrin, Nesbit, who represents condo, homeowner, and townhome associations. KSN is an experienced legal resource ready to provide you with quality advice and exceptional service. We look forward to demonstrating how we have earned the trust of thousands of clients over the past 35 years. If you'd like to reach Kelly or any of KSN's experienced attorneys, please call 855-537-0500. You can also visit ksnlaw.com and complete the contact form to send us a message. The music for the show is brought to you by freepodcastthemes.com. Please note that the material contained on the KSN podcast is for informational purposes only and does not constitute legal advice. No attorney-client relationship is established by your review or receipt of the information contained on the KSN podcast. You should not act on the information discussed on the KSN podcast without first obtaining legal advice from an attorney duly licensed to practice law in your state. While Kovitz, Shifrin, Nesbit has made every effort to include up-to-date information on the KSN podcast, the law can change quickly. Accordingly, please understand that information discussed on the podcast may not yet reflect the most recent legal developments. Material is not guaranteed to be correct, complete, or up to date. Kovitz, Shifrin, Nesbit reserves the right to revise or update the information and statements of law discussed on the podcast at any time without notice and disclaims any liability for your use of information or statements of law discussed on the podcast or the performance of the podcast generally. KSN Podcast may be considered advertising in some jurisdictions under applicable laws and/or ethical rules and regulations.